Hi, my name is Randy Bloom with the Minister Development Team with Church Administration. And I want to welcome you and thank you as a church pastor for your interest in starting small groups, faith talk groups in your congregation. This is an important step for you and your congregation. It's an important step toward helping your members grow in spiritual health and Christ-like maturity. It's an important step in helping your congregation and all your members grow in their participation in Jesus' ministry to the world around where your church meets and with their families and in their communities where they work and generally in the world in the context that they live in. Your role in this process of establishing a faith thought group in your congregation is vital. Your leadership, your vision, your passion, and your involvement in not only setting up faith thought groups, but also participating in a faith thought group is absolutely essential to the well-being and success of the groups that you establish. This lesson is designed for you, the pastor, to help you get started, to help you understand the nature, the purposes of faith thought groups. It's also to help you understand the key characteristics and the objectives that you want to work toward with your small groups and help them to become healthy, disciple-making, evangelistic, and multiplying groups that contribute not only to the health of your congregation, but also advance the kingdom of God in your context. So let's get started. Let's begin with the nature of faith thought groups, which of course is grounded in the triune God, the Trinity, Trinitarian theology, or just the understanding of the reality of the being of the Father, Son, and Spirit is the foundation for small groups. The community life, the activities, the purposes for faith thought groups all spring from the life of the Father, Son, and Spirit. From their mutual indwelling, their fellowship, their giving, their receiving, their sharing of life, all of which is meant to be reflected in faith thought groups. In Christ, members of faith thought groups seek to participate in Jesus' ministry, his life as servant leaders to other people, that by the power and the gifting of the Holy Spirit, they live a life of the parakletos, the one who comes alongside others to provide encouragement, to provide support and guidance for other people as they journey with Jesus in their spiritual lives. As the Holy Spirit focuses on an other, that is, the Holy Spirit focuses on Jesus, so leaders of faith thought groups and members of faith thought groups focus on other people, not just on themselves. They seek to connect with other people, to share the life and the love of Father, Son, and Spirit with other people, and to help them to believe God's love and to believe what Jesus has done for them and to live in it and to flourish in it. Communion is at the heart of each faith talk group. Ephesians 2 and verse 19 says, "You are a member of God's very own family, and you belong in God's household with every other Christian." And we want everyone to come to experience God's love and to take their place in the household of God. And faith talk groups can, and we hope are, an essential part of the process of helping new disciples, more people, come to live and flourish in the life of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, let's talk a little bit about characteristics. Some of the key characteristics of faith thought groups, the kind of groups that we're talking about. First of all, we want to seek to have groups that are holistic. That is, groups that worship, groups that pray, people study the Word together, study Scripture together, discuss it together, learn from it, grow from it together. Holistic means that there's fellowship, there's outreach, so that the activities of the small group are not just centered on the people of the small group, but new people were included, and that this is essential to a faith thought group, that new people always are included. It's a continual process of reaching out to new people and drawing them into the fellowship, and then discipling people as they participate in the life of the group. Size of groups. Groups can vary from, say, maybe three or four people up to about size of 15 members. you don't want to get too much beyond 15, because most people who work with small groups would agree that once you get past 15, they get to be a little bit unwieldy for a small group meeting in somebody's home or in a small meeting room, a small meeting place. And you also then begin, of course, to the dynamics begin to change into more like a small congregation rather than a small group. So really, when you get to about 15, you want to look at multiplying into another group. And you want to be intentional about that from the start. You want to explain it from the start to people that, hey, when we reach 15, we're going to be ready to multiply. And that means that we're going to be preparing for that from the start. So it's not a big surprise, and it's not something that people are caught off guard about, or they resist, but it's actually something that they look forward to and they work toward with you. Characteristics of FaithTalk groups have to do with group members who are involved in each other's lives outside of the weekly worship gathering that you have on Sunday morning, and even outside of the weekly or bi-weekly meeting that they might have as a FaithTalk group. I'll talk about frequency of meetings later in another lesson. Another characteristic, strong characteristic, that you want to work toward within your small groups is for each member of a FaithTalk group to befriend non-Christians, to share the gospel with non-Christians and draw them into Christ's community and help them grow as disciples of Jesus Christ. And each member working together to help each other experience transformation and maturity as followers of Jesus Christ. So, objectives of a FaithTalk group. First of all, to multiply new disciples. This, of course, has to do with evangelism, the big E word. Evangelism needs to be an essential part and at the heart of each small group from the beginning, which means that groups really need to start and shouldn't start without new people. They need to start with at least one or two new people, non-Christians, unchurched people, as a part of the group, with new people constantly being added in continually. Groups must be evangelistic in this way from the start, or they likely will not become evangelistic. That is, if they aren't that way from the start, they probably won't become that way. Experience shows that is usually what happens, is that if they're not inclusive of new people from the start, the people who are part of the group just become more focused inward. They're good friends hanging out together, taking care of each other, and that's fine. But really what you do is you lose the evangelistic component of participating with Jesus to reach new people that way. And certainly it also makes it much more difficult to multiply groups if you don't have new people coming in. So a key objective for a FaithTalk group is to work toward or to start from the very beginning and to maintain the intentionality of multiplying new disciples, evangelism. Getting people who are involved in the group in mission is a major objective for a small group, a FaithTalk group. Multiplying new ministry leaders needs to be a key objective for a FaithTalk group. And then, of course, eventually, as the group grows, as new disciples are multiplied, as leaders are multiplied, then new groups multiply. And as I said earlier, this needs to be intentional from the start. And then, of course, as new leaders multiply, as new groups multiply, then what you need to be on the lookout for is for the possibility, in fact, the likelihood of a new church starting, springing forth from a number of new FaithTalk groups that get started. So those are the key objectives for FaithTalk groups. Let's begin to talk about your key role as a pastor. What are some of the key roles, the key things that you need to be focused on and intently working toward as a pastor regarding FaithTalk groups? First of all, FaithTalk groups need to be a top priority, a major priority for you as a pastor. If they are, this is something that will come out in what you say, in what you do, and the people of your congregation will pick up on that. They'll see that it's important to you. It'll help FaithTalk groups to become more of a priority for them as well. Your role as a pastor is to cast a vision for FaithTalk groups, to help people of your congregation to understand how Faith Talk groups will fit into the mission and vision of your congregation. Your role as a pastor is to explain and to continue to explain the purpose for Faith Talk groups as a part of your mission and ministry, and to make Faith Talk groups a priority among the other ministries that your congregation is involved in. Not that it always has to be the top one, but it needs to be among the top ministries of your church, because the Faith Talk groups, if they live out the objectives and the purposes that we've been talking about, are going to be essential to your congregation being involved in the mission and ministry of Jesus Christ within their community context. So this means also then that Faith Talk groups need to have a high priority for you, for your time, your schedule, for your church calendar, and for your church budget. Now, you will notice on the blog where you are right now, where you're watching this video, that there is a link that takes you to some questions. All right, let's talk about your role as a pastor in initiating a group. The Faith Talk groups are going to be much more effective if you as a pastor are establishing relationships with non-church people and helping them to become a part of the life of the congregation. And in particular, in this context, you as the pastor are helping non-Christians and unchurched people to become a part of a Faith Talk group. Experience has shown, research has shown over and over and over again that for a group like what we're talking about to really take hold and to be effective and to be fruitful, pastors need to be involved in this way. Now, that doesn't mean you always have to be involved this way. It doesn't mean that you always have to start a group, that you have to start every group, and that you always have to lead a group. But to get it started and to convey and to model the importance and the priority of Faith Talk groups, and to model and to emphasize the importance of being missional, that is, being evangelistic, and reaching out to new people, it's essential that pastors are living this way and realigning their ministries and their time and their schedule so that they can do these things. Let's just say there are some really good valid reasons that you're not able to, or at least in the beginning you're not able to. You want to look for the best possible type of leaders, facilitators, to start a new group, one new group, a pilot group, and I'll talk about that in a moment. To find the best possible people to do this, and this could be tricky. We'll talk about the key characteristics of group facilitators, group leaders, in another lesson. But for now, it's important, and I hope you grasp the importance for you, the pastor, to be involved in this way, in starting a group and leading at least the first group to the point where it multiplies, and then you can look at transitioning out of that role of leadership. We'll talk about that in another lesson as well. Let's talk about the pastor's role as one who develops leaders and facilitators for your small groups. As a pastor, it's your place to identify and select people who are gifted to lead or to facilitate a Faith Talk group. It's your role to prepare them, to either train them or to help them obtain the training that they need, and then to coach them, and I'll explain coaching later in another lesson, and to support the facilitators for your groups. And of course, in the beginning, hopefully that's you. You want to be careful not to appoint leaders, but look for them. Some of your existing leaders may not fit the mold for an effective facilitator, and when you get to the lesson on facilitator characteristics, you'll see the kind of people that you want to be looking for. But it's your role as a pastor to identify those people and train them and deploy them. You want to look for people with missional gifts, people with evangelistic gifts, that is, people who already have relationships with unbelievers and who are engaged, already actively engaged with their community. You want to look for people with the key characteristics of facilitators that we'll discuss in another lesson. And then you want to receive some training yourself, which is what you're doing right now. There are other ways to receive training to set up and to establish Faith Talk groups. We'll talk about those later. But you want to receive some training yourself, and you also want to make sure that other people who facilitate groups receive training as well. I mentioned this earlier, your role as a pastor is that of a coach, that is, to provide support for your group facilitators, usually just one at first, and maybe a couple then over the years, more will be added. Your role will probably shift from being a group leader, a group facilitator, to becoming a coach, a trainer, a support system for facilitators for the number of groups that you have in your congregation. You, as a coach, you not only want to provide support for your facilitators, but you also want to visit your groups from time to time just as a visitor, just to see how things are going. Yes, to do some evaluation to see whether they're staying with the objectives and the purposes for the groups that you set them up as, evangelistic, multiplying, reaching new people, and so forth. So you want to do some evaluation, but as much as anything, what you want to do is just mainly maintain contact with people. You want members of your groups not only to have a connection with you as their pastor, but you want to ensure that the members of your various groups, also are connected to your congregation, but also to the denomination, to GCI. Because, yes, we are on mission with Jesus, but we're also doing so, hopefully we're all doing this, so also as this special body, the special part of the body of Jesus Christ that we call Grace Communion International. Note to pastors, don't use Faith Talk groups to build your church. Please don't approach this as a new program to try to get more people into your church. Let it occur, let it grow, let it develop naturally. Don't rush the process. Please don't give in to urgency. Take time to identify good leaders and give them the training that they need. Take the time that it takes to develop holistic, evangelistic, disciple-making groups. Don't rush the process. Don't rush the process of multiplying from 1 to 2 and then 2 to 3 or 4. Let the process of multiplication take place naturally. We'll talk about multiplying groups in another lesson. Let's talk about your first group. Most people advise that you start one group, especially with the small churches that we have. For the size of most of our GCI churches in the United States, you want to start one group. I just don't advise starting more than one. Start one and let it be led by you, and start with unchurched people. The reason why you want to start with one is you want to be sure that at least, to the best of your ability, that you know what you're doing. You're learning as you go, so if you've got multiple groups going, it's just going to make it harder to learn. It's going to be harder to kind of keep tabs on things and how things are going. It's going to be harder to train leaders. It's going to be more difficult to coach them. So start with one. Don't take on too much. Starting with one pilot group will allow you, it'll help you to ensure that you have in the DNA of that church the characteristics and the purposes and the objectives that you're looking for. Which are, remember, first of all, evangelism, including new people, as essential. And secondly, as multiplying groups. You don't want to multiply until a group is ready, that first pilot group. Just give it some time. Don't set a time limit on starting multiplying that group. Don't multiply it if new people aren't being added. If it's just the people of the church you already have who are part of that group, don't multiply it. Otherwise, what's going to happen is you're going to multiply a group that is not evangelistic. And that's not a bad thing. It's just that's not the objective and the key purpose that we're looking for with these kind of groups to advance the mission and kingdom of God. Don't multiply a group if leaders aren't being developed. You want to be sure that you've got the leaders that you need who have the characteristics and competencies to be able to facilitate a group before you multiply. And when you do multiply, multiply from the pilot group, because most likely that's the group that's going to take with it the people who go from that group to start a new group. If the DNA is there of evangelism, discipleship, multiplication, if that's there in that DNA, then it will be transferred to the next group. If you start another group, not from the pilot group, then it's going to be more difficult to ensure that DNA is there. Training for Faith Talk groups, just to give you an idea of what is available. Obviously, you know about this blog, and you're beginning to key into the training that's available on the blog via video and via some of the written material that the links take you to. However, if you would like a workshop, particularly if you like a workshop that you could invite other congregations in your district to who are interested in starting a Faith Talk group, then contact the Ministry Development Team members through Nancy Akers or one of the MDiv team members to schedule a workshop, a one-day workshop where we'll walk through the essentials for getting started with a Faith Talk group. I would encourage you, I urge you to read the resources that are listed with the written materials with this lesson. There are a number of very fine books that we highly recommend. We're praying for you. Let us know what we can do to help. We'd love to help. God bless you as you work to establish Faith Talk groups in your congregation.